This is a very, I don't know, this is a nice story. I remember as a kid getting like one of these, I think it was like a Voyager 1 playset. Voyager 1, you'll recall, was launched in 1977. It is an unmanned spacecraft. It was also, at that time, it was also launched, I believe, with Voyager 2. I don't know if they were both sent up simultaneously. I can't remember. Voyager 1 is now 18 billion kilometers away from the sun. It's moving at a speed of 17 kilometers per second. It takes 16 hours and 38 minutes for data to reach NASA on Earth. Voyager 2 is about 15 billion kilometers from the sun. Scientists now think that Voyager 1 has reached the edge of our solar system. It is, I guess it's just building on its record for being the most distant man-made object in space. And apparently the data that is coming back from Voyager 1, the way that they are basically telling that it that or surmising that it is at the edge of the spacecraft is because it, I mean the solar system is because it's sending records essentially or I guess evidence of an increase in charged particles hitting its monitors, I guess, its sensors. And scientists are saying that as we see this increase in charged particles, what they are basically charged particles coming from another solar system, from the creation of another solar system, meaning that it will be moving into sort of, I guess, interstellar space between, I guess we're on the edges of two different solar systems, one being ours and the other, I don't know. I guess that's the one where everybody from Battlestar Galactica is from. Simultaneous to Voyager 1 hitting the outer confines of our solar system, so too have we hit, even surpassed the confines of my own knowledge and ability to speak knowledgeably about space. I mean, I think we probably went past that in my discussion of my daughter allowing a helium-filled balloon to go up in the air. Apparently, the Voyager is powered by a plutonium, some type of plutonium power source. The probes are designed, or at least their propulsion mechanisms are designed to last until 2025. At that point, the probes will just keep hurtling through space, I guess inertia. However, they will not be sending data back to NASA. So we've got about another, I guess, 13 years of information that we will gather from Voyager 1 and 2. However, on Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, I guess there's like a little pod or, I don't know, briefcase or I don't know what they put it in. But in the event that they bump into any extraterrestrial life that has the ability to read or make heads nor tails of what we've sent out there, and of course this could happen after 2025, who knows? In these both these spacecrafts, there is a phonograph record, I guess an album, a 12-inch gold-plated copper disc with sounds and images of life and culture on Earth selected by a group chaired by the famous space scientist Carl Sagan. Now, the tricky thing about this is that, if someone was to get a hold of that gold-plated record now, they probably wouldn't be able to figure out how to pay for it. I mean, how to play it. So who knows? Hopefully, if we hit any extraterrestrial life, they'll either be behind us or so ahead of us in technology that they'll be able to play this album. But that's that. Hitting the outer reaches of our solar system.